everyone. Would you please stand with us? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we give you thanks. Lord, we give you the praise and the honor, Lord. Lord, you are our King. You are our God. Lord, you are our Savior. Lord, who bore our sins on the cross, Lord. Lord, I pray that as we come together, Lord, as a body, Lord, that our hearts and minds will be tuned towards your throne, Lord, and towards your grace and towards your mercy. Lord, I pray that you will be over this time of worship that we have. In your name we pray. Amen. Thanks to the Lord.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. He is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise
with a mighty hand.
Stretched on, his love endures forever. For the life that has been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise,
sing praise,
sing praise.
Find my rest, and without You've been good all the way.
Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you to our worship team once again for leading us into God's presence this morning. Welcome to each and every one of you. If you take a minute to take out your bulletins, we'd like to go over a few things with you, upcoming events and things you can be praying for. So I want you to be aware of all these things because you're going to be involved in church all week long through prayer and participating in these various activities. First of all, we're going to skip down to the second announcement where the tech team and the next to last announcement to the social team both need help. Up in the tech team, up in the tech booth, and the social team out doing the meal in between the services. Very simple and good ways to get involved in church ministry if you're not already, or if you'd like to try something a little different, get a little taste of a different kind of ministry. That's a great way to get involved. And during this social ministry, make sure to say happy birthday to Gus. 54 years young yesterday, right? All right. Well, happy birthday, Gus. There's also an announcement about some of our young adults heading off to missions adventures this summer. Abby Brothers down at Wildwood and Retta Hanna over in Hungary. And so you can read about that and pray about whether God would have you perhaps support them with finances or in prayer. And then the Memorial Day float, you can see the information on that coming up. That's if you're handy with your hands, that's a neat ministry to get involved in. Living in the Light, the addiction recovery ministry, has started up on Tuesday nights. And so if you know somebody that might benefit from that, make sure and let them know about it. And as the ushers come forward, I want to ask us to pray. We'll pray this morning for Pastor Gary and Lois as they come back from Florida today or tomorrow. Tuesday, thank you. And for Ken and Crystal Brothers as they come back from Iceland. Yeah, Iceland. They just took a little jaunt up there, you know, took the car. And anyway, pray for them as they come back this week from Iceland for safety and such. So let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your many blessings. We thank you for the blessing of worship and for providing these talented musicians and tech people to guide us into your presence each Sunday morning. We know that they spend a lot of time that we are not mostly privy to getting ready and preparing for this ministry, and it sure shows, Lord, and we thank you for them, each and every one of them. Thank you for Pastor Gary and Lois, for Ken and Crystal, and the chance you've given them to get away, and pray for safety as they travel back here to us. Watch over them, angels watching over them. And then, Lord, we pray for the offering this morning. We thank you for the privilege of giving to you, to your ministry. We pray that you would multiply these gifts, make them effective in reaching out to those who don't yet know you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand.
He's coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion. Of Judah is roaring with power and fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain. for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. Our God, who comes to save, is here to set the captives free. For who could stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power, fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power, fighting our battles, and every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, 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 oh.
Before you sit down, say good morning to one another.
Okay, thank you. All right, well, I was handed a prayer request as I walked up here, so I want to share this with you. Eileen Dreisbach, her neighbor, has a daughter who had a baby yesterday, grandson, first grandchild in the family. He was born 3 months early at 1 pound. So we want to pray for him, for his daughter, for the grandson, and the entire family. As you can imagine, that's quite a crisis in their life. So also, before we pray, I want to just mention, I forgot one of the announcements a little earlier about the men's breakfast, and I just want to encourage you to think about coming and join us this Saturday morning at Corba's at 8:30, isn't it? Yeah, at 8:30. So let's pray for Bill and his daughter and grandson. Father, we don't know him, Bill. We don't know his daughter. We don't know the grandson yet. But you do. You know every hair on their head. And so we pray that you would make your presence felt in this current crisis in their lives, that they would see you active and working to bring healing and peace into their lives. If they don't know you yet, that they might turn to you. If they do know you, that they might cling to you during this time. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, well, it's interesting that we start off with that, because today we're talking about crisis, specifically crisis in the church, but also crises in our lives. So I want to start with a question. How many of you have been through a crisis in your life? Raise your hand if you have. If you've been through a crisis, and I'm talking about serious things like death of a loved one, divorce, losing a job, losing a house, things like that, okay? So major crises in our lives. Well, the disciples in our, Peter and the disciples in our passage today in Acts chapter 1 are facing the first crisis in the church. In fact, the church isn't even established yet. This is kind of the pre-church. And so they're facing a crisis, and from this passage, we learn some principles for facing crises in our own lives that I want to bring to your attention. So before I get it, we read the passage together. I want to just give you a couple of verses as a background so that we can put this crisis in context as far as timing and context of the church. And so if we back up from Acts chapter 12, where we're going to start. In Acts chapter 4, it says, on one occasion, while Jesus was eating with them, he gave them this command, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. The Holy Spirit is what he's talking about. Then later on, it says, after this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. Men of Galilee, they said, talking to the disciples, why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way. And so that's the context. So they go back to Jerusalem into the upper room. We don't know if it's the same one where they celebrated the last Passover together, but it very well could have been. And so we're going to start reading at verse chapter 12, and I'm not going to have you read it this time, but I'm going to have you stand as we read God's word together. You'll see it on the screen, or you can follow it in your Bible. Acts chapter 1, starting at verse 12, says, then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present were Peter, John, James, and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. They all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. In those days, and this is what we're going to be talking about, in those days, Peter stood up among the believers, a group numbering about 120, and said, brothers and sisters, the scripture had to be fulfilled in which the Holy Spirit spoke long ago through David concerning Judas, who served as guide for those who arrested Jesus. What a condemnation, right? Left handed slap in the face. He was one of our number and shared in our ministry. Remember that. He was one of our number and shared in our ministry. With the payment he received for his wickedness, Judas bought a field. There he fell headlong, his body burst open, and all his intestines spilled out. Everyone in Jerusalem heard about this, so they called that field in their language Akeldama, that is, the field of blood. For 4 said, Peter, it is written in the book of Psalms, may his place be deserted, let there be no one to dwell in it, and may another take his place of leadership. Therefore, it is necessary to choose one of the men who have been with us the whole time the Lord Jesus was living among us, beginning from John's baptism to the time when Jesus was taken up from us. For one of those must become a witness with us of his resurrection. So they nominated 2 men, Joseph, called Barabbas, also known as Justice, and Matthias. Then they prayed, Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which of these 2 you have chosen to take over this apostolic ministry, which Judas left to go where he belongs. Then they cast lots, and the lot fell to Matthias, so he was added to the 11 apostles. You may be seated. So that's the passage, and that's what's going on in this event that we're going to be talking about today. Disciples, the women, some of his brothers, and some relatives of the disciples are up in the upper room, 120 of them, and they're in constant prayer, because that's what Jesus told them to do. Go to the upper room and wait for the gift that I'm going to send you. And so that's where we find the story started. And as they're praying, the Lord lays on Peter's heart that, hey, there's a crisis here, something we need to do. And so Peter stands up, and he gives the, you know, we got to replace Judas. He says, we got to choose 2 men. And then he gives the requirements, and then they cast lots, and they choose 2 men. And so let me just go through the outline with you so you can get a feel for how this story flows and how we, what we can learn about dealing with crises in our own lives from how the 120 dealt with this crisis in the pre-church. First of all, the crisis was identified. And we see that in Acts chapter 1, 12 through 20. And we see the cast of characters. Peter stands up and it lists the 120. Now, 120 is kind of significant. I didn't realize that until I was researching this message. But in Jewish law, when the Jews are dispersed from one place and have to go somewhere else, whether they're taken into exile or they're forced out of some place, it takes 120 Jewish men to form a new community where they can actually begin to raise money to build a synagogue. Before that, they can't do anything. They're just a group of Jews. But once you get 120, now they're an official Jewish community, and they can do all those official things. So that's a significant number that we start with, and one of the reasons I think that the cast of characters is listed along with the number, 1B, the number, 120. Now, one thing I want to mention about the cast of characters that I find interesting is that of all those disciples that are listed, and all, you know, the women and Mary and the brothers, not one of them is mentioned in the rest of the New Testament, with the exception of Peter, James, and John. They're mentioned throughout in certain places in the New Testament. None of the other disciples, Mary is not mentioned. His brothers are not mentioned again in the entire New Testament, just in this one place. So it's setting us up so we know what is going on. It's more for our benefit so we can learn what we need to learn about dealing with crises from this passage. And then in 1C is Peter's declaration, where he stands up and he states the problem. We've got to replace Judas. And many commentators say, well, the reason they had to replace Judas, you think, well, why can't they just go with 11 disciples? Well, because every time they would go out as a group of 11 disciples, people would look at that and say, look, there's 11. There used to be 12. And they'd be talking about the one who betrayed Jesus, and that would lessen the impact of their ministry, of, you know, Jesus' divinity, thinking, how can a God be betrayed? So they wanted to replace Judas so they would have that 12, that number of 12, when they ministered together. And so the first principle that we find in this passage for dealing with crises in our lives is that we must face crises realistically. All right, so we have the cast of characters in the, under number one. We have the number, and we have Peter's declaration. Then we have the principle. So I want you to just make sure you get this clear. That I'm being clear about this. We must face the crisis realistically, whatever the crisis is. All right. Well, I know one of my faults as a leader is that I tend to put my head in the sand when there's a crisis. I don't like confrontation. I don't like dealing with extras, you know, that along in the ministry or in my own life. So when a crisis comes up, my tendency is just ignore it. But in this passage, we see that the best way to deal with a crisis, face it head on, face it realistically, understand what the real issues are, because that's what they were doing here. The real issue is replacing Judas. All right, so then we have point number two, the crisis faced, or you could say the crisis dealt with. And we see that in verses 21 through 26. So Peter lists the requirements for replacing Judas. They're facing it realistically. Peter says, okay, here's the issue. Here's how we solve it. We have to find somebody that has been with us since Jesus was baptized by John at the Jordan River, and somebody who was with us to witness the resurrection. Those are the two key points in replacing Judas. It doesn't have to be the treasure like Judas was. It doesn't have to be anything that Judas was other than that he has to be, the person replacing Judas had to be with them the whole time and witness his resurrection. And then they boil it down in part B. They say they pick the two, Barabbas and Matthias. These two men had been with the disciples, maybe part of the 70 that they talk about in the Gospels, or some other group that was with the disciples the whole time. And then we find the method that they used. Now this is just interesting. I just share this because it's interesting. They cast lots. You might think, boy, that sounds kind of arbitrary, cast lots, doesn't it? Why don't they just pray? Well, remember, this is before Pentecost. So this is before the Holy Spirit comes and fills them with the Spirit. So they're kind of operating on human terms here. And casting lots was a well-known and well-respected tradition within the Jewish community for making decisions. In the Old Testament, we see them casting lots to divide up the land of Canaan for the 12 tribes. We see David dividing up. He's dividing up something in Numbers 26 by casting lots, and we find that Joshua determines who sinned and who caused the death of many Israelites in the Battle of Ai by casting lots. So this to us it would be kind of strange to sit down and, you know, roll dice or something to make a decision, but this is normal for them. So that's what they do. They cast lots to make the decision for who's going to replace Judas. But notice, they don't just cast lots. They pray. And they ask God to make the decision. They say, Lord, this is bigger than us. We don't know. So we're going to cast lots, and we're going to trust that you will decide who that disciple should be, because this is important. And we feel that you need to be involved in this and making the decision, not us. And so they cast lots, they pray. And we're going to come back to that when we get into the conclusion of the message. But you see, the principle here is that our go-to process must be prayer and the Word. Because Peter uses the Word of God to show why they have to pick a replacement for Judas. The verses from Psalms that he quotes indicate that Judas is, you know, gonna, his land will be desolate, and he needs to be replaced. And that comes right from the Word of God. It's not something Peter just makes up or comes up with on his own. It comes, so when we're facing a crisis, we need to focus on prayer and the Word, just as Peter did here and the disciples. And it was through that they were able to use the process of casting lots and allowing God to make this decision for them. Now look, I just want to be clear. I'm not recommending that you cast lots when you face a crisis. I'm recommending that you pray and get into the Word and see if there's anything it says about the crisis you face and how to handle it. Okay? All right, so let's go on to C under point two, and that is the sad lesson of Judas. And this is one of the saddest verses in the Bible, in my opinion, is verse 17, where it says, where Peter says, as he's making this declaration about Judas, he says, "He was numbered among us and obtained a part in this ministry." Isn't that amazing? Here's a guy. I thought this was quite amazing, and I found a quote from John MacArthur that expresses this better than I can, I believe. So I'm just going to read you this quote about Judas and the fact that he was a part of this ministry. He knew Jesus personally, interacted with him, talked to him privately at times. So let me just share with you what John MacArthur writes about this. He says, "Judas represents the greatest example of wasted opportunity in all of history. He had the rare privilege, given to only 12 men, of living and ministering with Jesus Christ, God incarnate, for more than 3 years. He had the same convincing, overwhelming opportunity to come to faith in him as the 11 did. Yet his motives for following Jesus were never anything selfish. He no doubt shared the common Jewish hope that Messiah would deliver the nation from the yoke of the hated Romans. And when it became obvious that that was not Jesus' plan, and Judas would not get the wealth and power that he wanted under Jesus, Judas decided to cut his losses and get out with whatever he could manage. Betraying the incarnate Son of God to the authorities for a paltry sum seemed a way to gain some compensation. The greed that he evidenced by that act was an avarice when, after Jesus' anointing with costly perfume by Mary, Judas indignantly exclaimed, 'Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?' His real concern was evident from John's editorial comment in verse 6. Now, Judas said this not because he was concerned about the poor, but because he was a thief. And as he had the money box, he used to pilfer what was put into it. So the disciples knew that Judas was not genuine. The disciples knew that this was not something that God put in John's mind that he hadn't known before. He had known, as I believe all the disciples did, that Judas was not like the rest of them. He wasn't sold on Jesus' agenda. He was in it for himself. And they knew that, and that's what John is saying here. Driven by disappointment and greed, this most tragic of all men squandered inestimable privilege, betrayed the Lord Jesus for 30 pieces of silver, and damned his soul to hell." What a sad verse, and what a sad commentary on Judas. And here is something where I think we must be very, very careful. We, in light of this passage, you and I need to regularly go to God with Psalm 139, and I don't know if it's right on the overhead, but I had it wrong in your outline. 139, 23 and 24, where it says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, test me, and see if there be any wicked way in me." Kind of a paraphrase there. But that's what we need to go to God regularly, because we may unknowingly be a Judas. If we are not totally committed to Jesus' agenda, but we somehow stray into making this our agenda, this whole church thing, and Jesus thing, right? People do that. Good, godly people do that. Now, Judas was not a Christian. He had not been saved. And I'm not saying that you, if you're saved, you generally have Christ in your heart, you're in danger of losing your salvation. But we're all in danger of losing that passion for Jesus that we have. And it comes very, Satan's very, very insidious in how he tends to move us from passionate followers to selfish followers of Jesus. And so we must regularly apply Psalm 139, 23 and 24 to our lives with open minds and open hearts. We can't just pray, "Lord, is there any wicked way? Okay, that's fine. Great, I'm glad there isn't." You know, we need to really allow God to speak to us and tell us if we're headed that direction, losing that passion. And so we come to point number three, the Judas principle. And I'm going to reference a Bible study that we've been doing in the life group that my wife and I lead, and it's called "Are You Not a Fan?" That's right. See, they're listening. Not a fan. This is a sermon that was preached by a guy named Kyle Eidelman in Southeast Christian Church, one of the largest churches in the country, fastest growing in the country for the last 10 years. And he turned it into a book and into a video series. Wonderful series, if you ever get a chance to look at it. And it talks about how many Christians, how we have to ask ourselves, am I a fan or a follower? You know, a fan sits in the stands and cheers, you know, and sings the choruses and raises their hands, and gets excited on a Sunday morning. And then the rest of the week, you know, it's kind of back to life as normal. A follower is somebody who follows every day, every moment of every day, Jesus and what he wants that this person to do in their lives. And so we need to find out, am I a fan or am I a follower of Jesus Christ? And you can make, if you're a sports person, you can make all kinds of connections here between being a fan of a sport or being a follower, somebody who plays the sport, who participates. So that's the Judas principle. Are you a fan or are you a follower? So let me go back to the principles of decision making in a crisis situation. And I want to, and I know this is kind of short, but we have a really special fellowship time meal. So I want to get you out there for that, to let you enjoy that. Pete and April have been talking about this for a couple of weeks, and they're real anxious for us to enjoy this fellowship time and the meal that they've prepared for us. So let me close with this conclusion. When we are facing a crisis, do these four things as Peter and the disciples did when they faced this first crisis in the pre-church. First, pray. Always pray first. Whether it's something good, something bad, crisis, a faith issue, whatever it is, pray first. Second, search the Word. Think about the verses you have memorized, hopefully. Go back through favorite passages. See what applies to the crisis that's in your life or your family. Third, seek others' input. Don't try to face it on your own. Notice Peter didn't just stand up and say, we're going to decide, and I'm going to pick Matthias. He stood up and said, we need to do this. Here's why. Here's the word. And we're going to do this together by having them cast lots. And everybody agreed. Now, if they didn't agree, they could have done it another way. But Peter sought their input to say, is that okay? And they said, yeah, that's okay. Let's cast lots. So seek others' input and then trust the process. Or in other words, now that's what they did. What we can do, because the Holy Spirit has come, it has filled us, we can trust the Spirit to lead us into the right decision. Let me just, I said I was going to close, but I lied. I'm going to share one more thing with you. Let me show you one interesting thing about this. If you look at Acts chapter 6, this is the second crisis in the church, and they do pretty much the same thing, but there's one major difference here. This is the crisis where a certain sect of Jews, there were a number of sects of Jews back in Jesus' day who came to Christ, and they were all living together, and they were all ministering together, and one of the sects felt like they were being discriminated about, and they came to the disciples about it, and they said, hey, this is not right. You know, this other group is getting more food than we are, because they were distributing it kind of community-wise. And so we read in chapter 6, in those days, the number of disciples was increasing. The Hellenistic Jews, that's one of the sects, among them, complained against the Hebraic Jews, another of the sects, because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, it would not be right for us the 12, to neglect the ministry of the word of God and prayer in order to wait on tables. Choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them. This proposal pleased the whole group. They chose Stephen, a man full of faith, Holy Spirit, and then it lists the other men they chose. Then it says in verse 6, they presented these men to the apostles who prayed and laid their hands on them. Now notice, they didn't go to God and say, God, we need you to make this decision. Why? Because the Holy Spirit had come in Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost. They were filled with the Spirit. So they knew that as they were praying, God was guiding them through the Spirit, because that's one of the jobs of the Spirit, is to lead us into all truth. And so they knew that God was guiding them as they prayed to pick the right men. So there's a difference there. And I just wanted to point that out to you as we close. And I hope that this has been useful to you. And if I didn't ask this question, I was going to ask this question when we started, and I don't want you to raise your hand. I asked the question initially, how many of you have faced crises in your life? And most of us raised our hands. But I was going to ask how many of us, and I don't want you to raise your hand for this, but how many of us are facing a crisis right now? I've kind of learned as I get older that life seems like it becomes a series of crises, just one after another. And how we handle it in our Christian faith determines whether we walk in contentment and peace and joy, or whether we walk in disillusionment and disappointment and discouragement. And so that's why I think this message is so important, is because we see the principles for handling crises. And if you're not in a crisis right now, you probably soon will be. I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but you probably will be. So if you're not in a crisis, don't think, oh, I don't need these principles. Take this with you. Save it somewhere, and when you face that crisis, pull it out. Look at those 4 points. You know, pray, search the Word, seek others' input, trust the Holy Spirit and the process that He gives you to face the crisis. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank You for Your Word. We thank You that every time we open it, You teach us something that we really need in our lives. Thank You for this particular passage and for the lessons that we learn here, the principles that we see that can help us to face the crises in our lives. And we pray that You would help us to remember them when the next crisis comes up, so that we can face it as You would have us to face it, in power, in Your power, and in Your joy. In Jesus' name, amen.
that you have given, or the promise of your word. Lord, I stand in wonder at the sacrifice you made, with mercy beyond measure. Jesus, your love has no bounds.
Jesus, Lord of heaven.
Jesus, Lord of heaven.
Jesus, Lord of heaven.
I do not deserve.
I do not deserve
the grace that you have given. Of your word, Lord, I stand in wonder at the sacrifice you made, with mercy beyond measure.
Pray that you'll be with us as we leave this place. In your name, amen.